What's up, Green Bay Packers fans? Welcome back, and as always, thank you for joining me. My name is Paul Brettle, the site editor over at Dairyland Express, where we cover the Packers, Brewers, Bucks, and Badgers. I also have a new article out every Monday and Friday over at Cheesehead TV. And as it says at the bottom of the screen here, you can follow me on Twitter at Paul_Brettle. So for today's episode, just as we've done the last few weeks, we're going to discuss basically what to watch for on Sunday as the Green Bay Packers take on the Ravens. Of course, there are a number of more items that could be listed, but these are the big ones to me anyways. You can find the article version of this over at Dairyland Express. Call it my five big questions. Again, I put this out every single week. The five big questions plus slash what to watch for as the Green Bay Packers take on their upcoming opponent. So let's dive in with the big one. Will Lamar Jackson play on Sunday? He left last week's game with an ankle injury. Throughout the week, Harbaugh has laid out that that the expectation, it sounds like, is for him to play. But Lamar didn't practice at all this week. He's listed as questionable. And you have to wonder if, to some degree, there's some gamesmanship going on here just to keep Green Bay guessing right up until kickoff about who the quarterback is going to be for Baltimore. Now, this week, Matt LaFleur said that, one, he kept crediting for the Ravens for all the exotic looks that they run in their offense. And two, he also mentioned that regardless of whether it's Huntley or Lamar Jackson, he expects a somewhat similar game plan from Baltimore. Now, with Jackson under center, the Ravens offense, they've struggled as of late, not including last week's game where he left early. In the previous five games, Jackson had completed just 60% of his passes at only 6.4 yards per attempt. He had 7 touchdowns to 8 interceptions, and in four of those games, Baltimore failed to score over 20 points. If he cannot go, then it's going to be Tyler Huntley, a 2020 undrafted rookie from Utah. He's appeared in 3 games this season. He's completed 68% of his passes at 6.2 yards per attempt with a touchdown and an interception. He also has 85 rushing yards as well. With either of these quarterbacks, it's going to be important for Green Bay to try to contain them, to keep them in the pocket, because they can both scramble and hurt opposing defenses with their legs. So, of course, this is going to be a big one to watch to see who is under center. Lamar Jackson, although he has struggled as of late, he is a former MVP, and we all know the caliber of play that he is capable of. Next up, everyone's favorite, special teams. We all know how bad the Green Bay Packers have been on special teams, especially last Sunday, where they had more mistakes in the course of a game than some teams are going to have over the course of an entire season. This week, they are up against a Ravens special teams unit that, by Football Outsiders metric, is the best in football. John Harbaugh, before he became a head coach, made his name in the NFL as a special teams coordinator. They absolutely emphasize it, and you can see those results on the field. So, as I talked about in my last video, if the Packers have those same kind of mistakes that they had against the Bears, against a more talented opponent, I mean, they were able to overcome those relatively easy just because the talent discrepancy between Green Bay and the Bears is huge. But when you go up against a talented Ravens team, or you meet the Buccaneers, the Rams, Cowboys, whoever in the playoffs, that can absolutely be a reason why you lose. So when you look at the best special teams unit in football up against the worst special teams unit in football, it could make this game a lot closer, or it could, hopefully not, but it could be the difference and give Baltimore the victory. We all know Justin Tucker. He's the best kicker in football, but they also are stout across the line. Their coverage units both rank in the top 5, punt and kick coverage units both rank in the top 5 in terms of average yards allowed per return. Devin Duvernay, he ranks 8th as a kick returner in average yards per return, and he leads the NFL as a punt returner in average yards per return. So kick return unit, punt return unit, kick coverage unit, punt coverage unit, and field goal kicker. The Ravens all rank among the best in the game. And of course, the Green Bay Packers, they struggle in just about every aspect of special teams play. So something to definitely keep our eyes on. Again, these type of mistakes, hopefully it's cleaned up, but at this point in the season, we know who the Green Bay Packers special teams unit is. There isn't going to be this magical turnaround where they all of a sudden put it together. They are who they are at this point. We just need to hope that there isn't this slew of blunders like there was against Chicago, because against a Ravens team who will very much capitalize on that, that could absolutely be the difference between a win and a loss this coming Sunday. Next big question, what to watch for. How many pass attempts is Aaron Rodgers going to have? I wrote a more detailed version of this over at Cheesehead TV on Friday, so check that out, please. But, and you all know, if you read my work, if you watch these, I'm a huge, huge proponent of establishing and sticking to the run game. Yes, you have Aaron Rodgers. Yes, you have Davante Adams. But what really makes this offense go, or what when they're at their best and clicking, is when Aaron Jones, A.J. Dillon are involved in the run game. We've seen throughout the past, when they get pass heavy, that is when things can very much go south for this offense. But this week, I could very much see a Rams-like performance from Green Bay. Aaron Rodgers had his season-high 45 pass attempts that game. And when we look at this Ravens defense, obviously I mentioned you want to try to take advantage of the run game, but they've been very good against the run. They're allowing only 3.9 yards per rush this season. They rank 7th by DVOA in run defense. Now, Calais Campbell, who is one of the better interior run defenders in the game this season, right in the middle of that Ravens defense, he is doubtful. So very likely that he is not going to play, which of course will make things easier for Green Bay. But when you're looking at the opponent, this Ravens defense, and talking about who, what you want to exploit, it's the passing game. Their secondary is depleted. Of their 4 week one starters, the two corners, two safeties, none of them will be on the field. Three of them are on IR. One was just placed on the reserve COVID list. If you look at yards per attempt allowed, passing yards per game allowed, explosive play rate, the Ravens rank in those three categories either last or second to last. This secondary is absolutely ripe for the picking for Aaron Rodgers and Davante Adams, as well as the rest of the pass catchers. So the run game, is obviously it's supposed to be a part of the game plan. Whenever we're discussing this, it's never one or the other. It's a combination of the two. I just think that we are going to see more of a Rams game where Rodgers has 45 pass attempts or closer to that than, you know, a number of the other games this season where he's at 32, 33, 35 attempts. I think that Green Bay is really going to try to exploit that Ravens secondary, because even with Calais Campbell not in the middle of that Ravens run defense, that is absolutely the weak point of that unit. On the flip side, can Green Bay slow the Baltimore run game? As I had mentioned previously, Matt LaFleur expects the Ravens offense, whether it's Huntley or Jackson, to be somewhat similar, and that means they're going to run the ball. The Ravens, on average rush attempts per game, they have almost 32 per game this season. That's the third most in football. They're averaging 4.6 yards per rush, which ranks 6th, and then they're 7th by DVOA as well. So that's, of course, a combination of the running back, but also quarterback play. Lamar Jackson leads the Ravens in rushing. He has almost 800 rushing yards. And even if Tyler Huntley is under center, it's a very, very small sample size, of course, but on 16 rush attempts this season, he's averaging almost 6 yards per carry. And when we're talking rush attempts for either of those quarterbacks, it's scrambles, but also some designed plays mixed in there as well. So as I mentioned, it's going to be important for the interior defensive line to get a push, and Green Bay is going to have to do so without Kenny Clark, who's on the reserve COVID list. There is the possibility they could play, but I do not believe that that's the expectation whatsoever. So fortunately, we've seen elevated play from Dean Lowry. We've seen elevated play from Kingsley Keke this season, but doing that, getting that push with Kenny Clark next to you versus no Kenny Clark and having to do that on your own, two completely different things. And then Matt LaFleur also mentioned that we can expect a heavy dose of TJ Slayton this week as well, which I'm excited for. I've always been a big fan of the Slayton pick just because of what he adds to this defense. It was a skill set that they didn't really have outside of having to lean on Clark to play as the nose tackle, but now he has the over round, and I think we're seeing that with his production over the course of the season. But we've seen those flashes from Slayton. We've seen him generate some nice push up the middle. We've also seen some rookie mistakes as well, which is expected. He's a fifth round pick, but it's a very small sample size. There's only been one game this season. It was against Kansas City where he played over 17 snaps. He had 45 that game because Clark left early, and that was one of those games where he did perform well. But in 8 of his games, he hasn't even reached double digits in terms of snaps. So he's going to be thrust into a much bigger role against this Ravens front. And as I had mentioned earlier, it's going to be incredibly important that Rashawn Gary, Preston Smith, that they're able to hold a solid edge to do their best. It's not going to be easy, but to do their best to try to keep Lamar Jackson or Tyler Huntley in the pocket. We've seen against, like, Kyler Murray, for example, another very mobile quarterback. We saw Green Bay do a decent job of that when they took on the Arizona Cardinals, and we didn't see really a ton of extended plays from Murray. So they're going to need to have a similar strategy and really be disciplined in doing so, because if, and we've seen this from Rashawn Gary at times, if he gets too far upfield and Jackson or Huntley is able to step up in the pocket, it's going to create huge running lanes. We saw that last week with Justin Fields as well. I think, again, that was an area of emphasis. But we've seen Taylor Heineke, of the Washington football team hurt Green Bay with his legs. Even Jared Goff did, again, with the Lions in week two. So the quarterback's ability to extend the play, it's going to extend drives. It's an added element. And we may see Devondre Campbell as well in a spiral. This whole season, Joe Barry's MO as defensive coordinator has been take away the pass, and if you want to run the ball, go ahead and run the ball, but we're not letting you pass. This week, I'm going to be very curious to see if they switch that approach up. Play with less light boxes, have Campbell up there to spy on the quarterback, maybe send some pressure, extra defenders, but more so try to take away the run game. And again, same with the offense. When we're talking about run pass, it's never one or the other. It's always going to be a mixture. It's just, what is that ratio? So that's something to definitely keep our eyes on this week, because taking away that Baltimore run game is going to be important. And there's a reason, and that's a big reason why the Ravens, they're first in the NFL in time of possession. They like to control the clock. The Packers are second, but they like to control the clock, and that is going to be one of their keys to victory this week, is controlling the clock and keeping Aaron Rodgers on the sidelines. So like I said, I think he's going to have a lot of success against this Ravens defense. Last up, Dennis Kelly at right tackle. My question that I posed in the article, and really I think it could apply to the entire offensive line, is how are they going to hold up? And it's a question that we could probably ask from now through the end of the season, just because of all the injuries that have occurred. The Packers have held up very well despite, but they're down four of their five preferred starters. And this just goes to show the absolute depth of this unit. Week 14, Billy Turner goes down, your fourth tackle option of the season. Obviously, David Bakhtiari would be option one, but Elton Jenkins, Yash Nyman, and then Dennis Kelly, your fourth option at tackle, comes in off the bench. And this, your fourth option at tackle, is someone who was a starter at right tackle all of 2020 for the Tennessee Titans. Hit over 1,000 snaps on the season. He didn't allow a single sack. You do not see that kind of depth. Brian Gutekunst has put together an incredibly deep unit. Matt LaFleur, Adam Stenovich have done a fantastic job of coaching them up. And of course, players deserve a ton of the credit as well. But Kelly stepped in last week and he did a very, very good job for Green Bay. Aaron Rodgers was quick to praise him right after the game. Matt LaFleur said he graded out very well in the Packers grading system when they go back and rewatch the game. Didn't allow a pressure, was solid against the run. This week he's going to be up against a good Baltimore pass rush. It features Justin Houston, and the Ravens are going to, I imagine that they're going to really try to blitz Rodgers as well because of his ability to what he can do in the passing game. I mentioned that the Ravens secondary is banged up, so they have kind of two options. They can try to, provide more help in the secondary, or they can just go after Rodgers. Both have their pros and cons, but Rodgers, by several Pro Football Focus metrics, completion percentage, yards per attempt, passer rating, he's actually been one of the worst quarterbacks this season when under pressure. So I imagine that this offensive line, Dennis Kelly, they're going to have to deal with a number of blitzes, because to me, that seems to be the better solution than just trying to put more players in the secondary to provide help. Because if Aaron Rodgers has time, Aaron Rodgers, Devontae Adams, they're going to do what they do. They're going to pick apart opposing defenses. So I expect this offensive line to have to deal with a number of blitzes, including Dennis Kelly on the right side. And as far as the run game, as I mentioned, the Ravens are very stout against the run, one of the best in football. No Calais Campbell. He ranks 8th by Pro Football Focus run defense grade, ranks 11th in run stop percentage. So that is a huge loss for the Ravens. Should make life a little bit easier for those interior offensive linemen, as well as when it comes to running the ball. But like I mentioned, I think every week we can ask, how's this offensive line unit going to hold up? Just because all the injuries have occurred. And as we've seen, they have to be accounted for. Matt LaFleur, Aaron Rodgers are going to rely on the quick passing game, tight end chips, motion, play action, running the ball, letting them be the aggressor. There are things that Green Bay will do to provide them some help. But, of course, the offensive line, just given the state of it, always worth keeping our eyes on. So there you have it, folks. Those are my five big things to watch. As I said, you can find that article at Dairyland Express. You can follow me on Twitter at TZTV. Also find my work at at Paul_Brettel, and you can find my work at Cheesehead TV. I appreciate you guys tuning in. Enjoy the game tomorrow. Stay safe. And as always, go Pack Go.